The Philippines' anti-drug campaign shifts its approach to prevention and rehabilitation of drug dependence. Several reforms eyed to decongest the country's prison facilities. And cheaper pump prices expected next week. Good afternoon, I'm Stanley Palisada. You're watching Top Story. Welcome to the program. The Philippine Justice Department and the Bureau of Corrections are studying reforms to decongest the new Bilibid prisons and make it easier for families to visit their detained loved ones. ABS-CBN's Michael Deliso joins us on the line to tell us about government's regionalization plan. Michael, go ahead.
Hi, Sandy. Good afternoon. The Bureau of Corrections is planning to separate persons deprived of liberty, or PDLs, according to the crime they committed as part of reforms in a state penitentiary following a series of controversies. Bureau Corps officer in charge, Gregorio Pio Catabang Jr., said there is already a regionalization plan to decongest the new Bilibid prison, which can only accommodate 6,000 inmates but currently detaining 28,000. This includes the separation of PDLs who committed heinous crimes such as murder, rape, and drug-related violations in each region. The Bureau Corps has already identified areas of regionalization, which include Central Luzon, Mimaropa, Eastern Visayas, Zamboanga Peninsula, and Davao Region. The regional prisons will also have minimum, maximum, and medium facilities. A facility at Military Reservation Fort Magsaysay in Nueva Ecija can be utilized as early as next year, according to Catabang. Regionalization of prisons, Justice Secretary Boy Rimulya said, would solve the problem of families from the provinces having a hard time visiting their loved ones in prison in Muntinlupa City in the National Capital Region. The regionalization of prison is also seen to address the piling up of remains of dead PDLs that are unclaimed, supposedly due to the transportation issues of their families. Back to you, Stanley.
All right. Thanks a lot for the update, Michael Deliso. Moving on, the Philippine government launches a revamped drug war. The focus this time around, deterrence in the grassroots level and rehabilitation. Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos says drug pushers will be offered livelihood assistance. Drug users, on the other hand, will be rehabilitated. Authorities will also ramp up coordination with village officials and civil society groups to discourage the youth from engaging in illegal drugs. This is a 180-degree turn from the Duterte administration's drug war, which left thousands dead and was marred by alleged human rights violations. Despite the changes, Secretary Abalos asserts the revamped drug war will be tough.
Hindi tayo titigil, hindi lang yung malalaking isda, hindi lang yung mga maliliit pa. Ang importante, yung tinatawag ng demand reduction, yung mga gumagamit ng droga. What is more important is this is the whole of the nation approach. Pupunuin namin ang kulungan ng mga pusher. Gagawin namin ang lahat para matigil ang droga, kung ano sinasabi ng batas. Kung nagkamali ka, huli ka.
The Philippines' Human Rights Commission welcomes government's decision to shift its approach on the war on drugs. The CHR reminds authorities to ensure any anti-drug initiatives must be consistent with international human rights standards. This comes as the government puts more emphasis on rehabilitation and preventing drugs from being introduced to communities. The commission also says drug dependents should be allowed to volunteer for rehabilitation instead of making it mandatory. Some relief for motorists. Hefty fuel price rollbacks expected next week. Estimates show a liter of diesel may be cheaper by up to 4 pesos on Tuesday. Gasoline prices, meanwhile, may see a 1 peso markdown. Now, the Energy Department cited the spike in COVID cases in China for the decrease in prices. Operations at the light rail transits Line 1 to be suspended on December 3rd and 4th. That's to give way to the integration of the Roosevelt Station in Quezon City with the entire 19 stations of the LRT. Operations will resume by December 5th. That's Monday. Train officials are appealing for understanding and urged passengers to plan their trips ahead. The Roosevelt Station was previously closed in 2020 for the construction of a common station to connect the LRT with the Metro Rail Transit. A transport advocacy group is challenging government officials to take public transportation and experience what it is like for commuters. OutMobility Philippines says there is no sense of urgency for those who make policy decisions since they enjoy vehicle support from government. The group also urged transport officials to finally resolve issues hounding modernization programs of the public utility vehicles. They are also pushing for lawmakers to revisit the composition of the Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board, saying the agency lacked representation from other stakeholders.
There's nothing wrong with big-ticket projects like the subway or MRT. It's just that it doesn't happen until 5 or 10 years later. The PUV modernization program has been pending for the last 3 years, at the very least, to revisit the composition of LTFRB. If you look at the current composition of the LTFRB, we are sorely lacking transport planners. We are lacking members of the civil society. We are lacking members of the transport sector in deciding on things that affect our welfare.
Improving the country's mass transportation systems will greatly benefit both commuters and road users. However, this won't happen overnight, leaving everyone with no choice but to grin and bear Metro Manila's notorious traffic. Now, the Metro Manila Development Authority and other government agencies have recently formulated 12 strategies that will help address road congestion. For this, we are joined by MMDA spokesperson, Attorney Mel Karunungan. Good afternoon, Attorney Karunungan, and welcome to Top Story.
Good afternoon, Sir Stanley, and to all those watching.
It's good to have you here. Now, the traffic situation in Metro Manila is almost, if not totally, back to pre-pandemic levels. Some say it's gotten better, others saying it's gotten worse. It's quite subjective. So what is the real feel in the metro roads today? I mean, has it really worsened or gotten better?
Actually, sir, it's gotten better. So last November 10, 2022, The Traffic Engineering Center of the MMDA po was able to record volume of vehicles along EDSA is at 398,274 vehicles. So this is around the same already, sir, as the pre-pandemic levels. However, the travel speed has improved now as compared to before. So last January 2020, the travel speed of vehicles going northbound on EDSA was at 21.67 kph and southbound at 11.02. However, as of September 2022, the speed of the vehicles northbound on EDSA is now at 24.44 kph, while southbound is at 19.67 kph.
And why do you think is that? I mean, what attributed to that improvement?
Sir, the Director for Traffic Engineering Center attributes the improvement to, first and foremost, the bus carousel, as well as the traffic management and the discipline of the drivers on the road.
All right. Now, the public's always harped on a more long-term solution, if you will, to the traffic problems here with stakeholders, including the Metro Manila Development Authority, of course, and the local government traffic units, often getting the flak for experiments on action plans for traffic. Now, you have a traffic management plan, finally, an action plan, of course, taking into account decades of studies. Tell us briefly about the action plan.
So the five-year management traffic plan, sir, it covers strategies to address the traffic management issues in Metro Manila. So It aims to further improve the traffic corridors, which, for example, are our roads and highways, to enhance our ITS, or the Intelligent Transportation Systems, to strengthen our traffic regulations around the whole Metro Manila, so as well as enforcement of road safety, promote active transportation, and also develop a comprehensive traffic management database, sir.
All right. So, in fact, there are 12 strategies to address traffic management issues. Which to you are most important?
Sir, in the meeting, the most recent meeting, they identified the most important strategy to be addressing the traffic bottlenecks in Metro Manila. So during the planning stages of this traffic management plan, sir, there was a memorandum of agreement signed by Waze and MMDA. This is called Waze for Cities, where we were able to use the data from Waze, sir, to see the level of congestion as well as the travel speed in different parts of Metro Manila. So from their survey, they were able to identify 42 priority bottlenecks, which are the most important to address at the moment.
All right. Aside, of course, from the strategies, there are also projects in the offing. Tell us about these projects, at least the very major ones, to address the traffic problem.
Sir, one of the accomplishments already from the action plan is the beginning of the technical working group meetings for the single ticketing system in Metro Manila. So the technical working group is composed of representatives from the different traffic agencies such as LTO, MMDA, and the traffic heads of the LGUs. So we already had three technical working group meetings, sir. And in these meetings, we're already beginning to create a Metro Manila traffic code where we want to harmonize the definitions of the traffic violations, fines, and penalties in Metro Manila, sir.
All right. Now, you mentioned you've involved the local government units, particularly their traffic management divisions, because each of the 17 metro cities have a unique traffic challenge and must have strategies specifically customized to address these challenges. Now, what kind of support are they getting, and does this include funding? If yes, how much money are we looking at to make this work, and where is financing coming from?
So the kind of support that the LGUs are getting is the coordination among the stakeholders to address the traffic management issues in their LGUs as well as in Metro Manila. So we are also trying to provide them, sir, with interconnection with the LTO database and also harmonize all of the traffic violation definition, penalties, and fines. As for the funding, sir, so the comprehensive traffic management plan, sir, for the technical assistance, this was provided by JICA, or the Japan
International Cooperation Agency.
Yes, sir. Right. As for the succeeding projects, sir, it depends if it will come from the General Appropriations Act or technical assistance from other sources.
All right. Attorney Carunuan, badly managed traffic systems are taking a toll on the economy, with millions, of course, lost daily from delays. Now, a well-managed and reduced traffic congestion can also, in turn, be good for business and eventually for the economy. Now, it's also a collective responsibility of the public, the various stakeholders, and the part of overall vision of inclusive, people-oriented mobility. Expound more on this vision.
Yes, sir. So the transportation costs of those who use roads, including the vehicle operating costs and travel time costs, as you said, sir, it reaches millions or billions in Metro Manila. So through the comprehensive traffic management plan and the planning committee, sir, we were able to use technology similar to Japan, such as Strada, VSIM, Local SIM, and we created a micro simulation of what we hope to be the outcome of this 5-year action plan. So it was seen in this micro simulation that the travel speed could improve by, there could be a reduction in travel time by 23%. So we hope to actualize this action plan, sir, to address these traffic management issues that are seen as a hindrance to the improvement of our economy.
And of course, following the approval of that action plan, what are the next steps, and when do you foresee the implementation of the action plan? And of course, how can people or the public contribute to the solution?
Sir, so the team of the comprehensive traffic management plan has already been meeting for the past 3 years, even during the pandemic. The next step, sir, is really to implement the plan. Right now, sir, we're already continuing the technical working group meetings for the single ticketing system. The Metro Manila Council will meet later with our Chairman Attorney Artes and also DILG Secretary Ben Herabalos Jr. They will address the single ticketing system as well as other issues, sir. And as for the how others can contribute, well, as we can see from the improvement of our travel speed along EDSA, they can contribute by continuing to be disciplined on the road. They can also use the Mabuhay lanes on the part of the MMDA. We continue to clear these You can use it, sir, to decongest the traffic congestion on the major thoroughfares.
And lastly, speaking of Mabuhay lanes, this is the season where traffic congestion could be worse, the Christmas season in the next couple of weeks. What is your advice to the public who are traveling around Metro Manila during this time?
So for those who can avoid the major thoroughfares such as EDSA, they can use, sir, the Mabuhay lanes. The part of the MMDA, we clear these lanes every day. We remove the obstructions so that they can be used as alternate routes, sir.
All right. Thanks a lot for your time. Attorney Mel Karunungan, MMDA spokesperson. Thanks for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you, Sir Stanley. Thank you.
Moving on, a new, more contagious, highly immune, evasive Omicron subvariant has reached the Philippines. The health department confirms the country has logged 14 cases of the BQ.1 subvariant that's driving up cases in the U.S., United Kingdom, and parts of Europe. Of that number, 13 are local cases in 5 regions. The health department says there is still no epidemiologic data to suggest the BQ.1 subvariant causes severe infection. But it reminds the public vaccination and observing health protocols are still key in fighting COVID.
It is high time for us, no, that our mindset be that yes, we are aware that there are these variants and sub-variants being detected in the country, but we should also be aware that whatever variants or sub-variants that may be detected, our protocols for us to get protection and also to protect our family are all the same. We practice our minimum public health standards and also we get ourselves vaccinated.
The Philippines on Friday logged over 1,300 new COVID infections, bringing active cases to nearly 18,000. 24 new deaths were also added. Filipinos urged to be vigilant with the detection of the new Omicron subvariant as the holiday season approaches. Professor Ranjit Rai of the Okta Research Group sees new COVID cases at home slightly rising due to the BQ.1 subvariant. But he believes the public can still have a safe holiday season. Rai calls on more Filipinos to get their booster shots and continue complying with health protocols.
We must enjoy the holiday season, but we must be mindful also that COVID is still here. Mm-hmm. And that we now know that because of the improvements in treatment, the vaccine coverage, natural immunity also, that we won't be expecting the same kinds of waves, no, that we had early part of this year when we had the first Omicron wave. No? Mm-hmm. That being said, we can protect ourselves if we have ourselves vaccinated or boosted and if we follow minimum public health protocols. Mm-hmm. This is the playbook for the next few months to a year until COVID becomes endemic.
Overseas, COVID cases in Hong Kong on the rise. The city reported over 9,000 more infections Friday from nearly 3 months. Many of the new cases have been detected in schools and in nursing homes. Officials have since ruled out further easing COVID restrictions. The fresh uptick in cases attributed to the detection of new COVID variants, such as the highly transmissible XBB, among others. Back here at home, the Philippines records an increase in leptospirosis cases in the first 10 months of the year compared to the same period last year. Vivian Gulia with the details.
Leptospirosis cases in the Philippines from January 1 to October 29 climbed to a total of 2,794, according to data from the Department of Health. This figure is 68% higher compared to the same period last year, which was at 1,661. The number of deaths due to leptospirosis is also up at 370 from 178 in 2021. The Department of Health reminds the public that leptospirosis cases increase during rainy season as more people wade through flood waters that may be contaminated with urine from rodents and animals infected with the bacteria Leptospira.
Well, ang leptospirosis, expectedly, especially during the rainy season, it increases. It's just that right now, it is kind of more emphasized because there would be, on top of the non-communicable diseases or those people who have these kidney ailments.
Among the symptoms of leptospirosis are fever and chills, head and muscle aches, red eyes, vomiting, and jaundice or yellow skin and eyes. A nephrologist says once these symptoms show at 2 to 14 days from exposure to contaminated water, one should immediately consult a doctor.
It's just a flu-like symptoms pagka po yung mga early stages of the leptospirosis. So kung hindi ka magkonsulta at hindi malakas ang resistensya ng katawan, maaaring lumala yung leptospirosis. Ang worst case scenario na pwedeng mangyari is yun nga, maaari kang madialysis dahil sa severe forms of leptospirosis.
Leptospirosis is among the illnesses driving up the number of patients seeking dialysis treatment at the National Kidney and Transplant Institute. To assist the NKTI, the DOH says the Philippine National Police and the Philippine Army committed to deploy some of their nurses.
We can open up the gym in NKTI, put there the extra dialysis machines, and those that will man these dialysis machines are our assistance coming from PNP and AFP. These are their nurses and their doctors. As far as Batangas Medical Center and some of our hospitals within NCR have already committed that they will be deploying nurses so that they can manage the number of cases quarantined in NKTI.
To prevent leptospirosis, avoid contact with water or soil that may be contaminated with urine from potentially infected animals. And if wading through floods cannot be avoided, wear boots. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
An update now on the weather. Philippine State Bureau Pag-asa says the Intertropical Convergence Zone, or ITCZ, is affecting Mindanao and Palawan. It is expected to bring cloudy skies with isolated rain showers and thunderstorms to the rest of the country. Pag-asa warns flash floods and landslides can occur during severe thunderstorms. The public is advised to be vigilant, particularly those living in areas recently hit by storms. One of the areas affected by rains is Pigcawayan in Cotabato. Nearly 100 families evacuated after a river overflowed and flooded some areas. Some displaced residents are staying at a covered court where modular tents have been set up for them. Authorities have also provided food for evacuees. We'll take a short break. Stay with Top Story. Welcome back. More and more Filipinos falling victim to investment scams. A cybersecurity expert warns these scams could rise this holiday season. Jackie Pascual reports.
This is the group chat of investors who found out they can no longer withdraw the money they invested in an app allegedly engaged in investing in cryptocurrency. This app, which was available in popular online app stores, supposedly makes you earn more than other established trading platforms. But this investment opportunity has turned into an expensive lesson for many victims like Paul, who calls it an investment scam.
They invested a lot. Like, kailangan ko mga tatlong trade, apat na trade, mag-invest ako. Yung iba nga may pamapasok $10,000, ganun. Tapos nagpapasok talaga sila. So, syempre, and then, at first, it was going well. Then, nung nagsubok na yung iba na mag-withdraw, ayun na, doon na naglabasan yung red flags.
Paul lost 30,000 pesos, but some of his colleagues invested up to 500,000 pesos. He admits, at first, everything appeared legal and legitimate, since there were charity events and even a physical meetup. Their e-wallet inside the app grew daily, and they were still able to withdraw the money in the first few weeks. However, when October rolled in,
sabay-sabay na wala yung app, nag-delete sila, sabay-sabay sila lahat na wala.
A cybersecurity analyst says this kind of investment is a scam because there is no real trading activities even if there was crypto features in the app. Other apps and websites have victimized thousands of Filipinos, and the number may grow this holiday season when people receive their Christmas bonus pay.
Nagre-recruito ng mga tao para mag-invest daw. Pero ang investment na to, ang mangyayari, kukolektahin lang yung pera mo. Pagkatapos, mawawala na sila. May inganyo ka kasi sasabihin nila na kung mas malaki yung in-invest mo, mas malaki sana makukuha mo. Pero isang uri ito ng scam.
Samaniego says the public should look out for red flags.
Pag may pangako na double your money, iwasan nyo na. Itong mga app na to ngayon, nangangako sila ng 3,000 mo, magiging 35,000 in 3 hours. Iwasan nyo yan. Yan yung unang red flag. Pag ang investment scheme na pinasukan mo, nanghihingi ng pera para makakuha ka ng pera na mas malaki, scam yan.
Paul reveals there are over 1,000 investors in that one app alone and the total money loss would reach millions of pesos. The Securities and Exchange Commission has issued several advisories in recent months against companies offering investments but have no permits. The SEC urges the public to think before investing their money, study the company and the investment process, and know the company's address, landline number, and if they have SEC registration as an investment taker. One may also check the website or social media pages of the SEC and the Central Bank for advisories.
Pag pera na ang involved, dapat pag-aralan mo, tignan mo kung saan papunta yung investment na to. At pag mayroong kang duda, kahit konting duda, tumakbo ka na palayo.
Paul and other victims plan to file a case before the NBI with the hopes of getting back their hard-earned money. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Those were the top stories today. I'm Stanley Palisade. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.